Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Guilty Plea by Robert Rotenberg, narrated by Paul Hecht and directed by Chris Thies. The author opens with the following quote from Anatomy of a Murder by Robert Traver. Despite all the rules and objections and soft illusion of decorum, a trial was, after all, a savage and primitive battle for survival itself. And now, The Guilty Plea.
Part 1. August. Chapter 1. Even for Arseli Okaya, it was too hot to sleep. The heat wave had gripped the city for days, and by 6 in the morning her tiny apartment was already steaming. Back home in Manila, her husband and their 5 children would never believe it could be so warm in Canada. By next summer, when she brought them over, Okaya planned to have a bigger place, and she knew they would never understand what it had been like, all these years alone with the summer heat, the winter cold, and the eternal loneliness. It was good that she was up early. Her employer, Mr. Terence Wyler, would need all the help she could give him this morning, poor man, even though he was rich. The bus she took every day to the subway arrived on time, but there was a delay on Eglinton Avenue where a film crew was making a movie. This happened so many times in Toronto. The trailers parked on the side of the road funneled the traffic. Okaya saw a stone building with a new sign that said Circuit Court, Baltimore, and police cars with the words Baltimore City Police on the side. Unfortunately, most people on the subway were reading the transit newspaper, which had a picture of Mr. Wyler right on the front page with his arm around his famous American girlfriend, the actress April Goodling. The headline read, Divorce from Hell. Trial starts today. Why do they write such terrible things, Okaya wondered. Her employer was the nicest person she'd worked for since leaving the Philippines. At her last subway stop, Bayview Avenue, she rushed up the escalator. Oh, no, she thought when she got to street level and saw the back of the bus pull away, its tailpipe spitting out sooty black smoke. She decided to walk the 6 blocks to his house. Marching up Hillside Drive, Okaya couldn't stop thinking about that foolish headline, Divorce from Hell. Try being separated from your family for 6 years and only getting to go home to see them once. That was hell. This divorce was silliness. Mr. Wyler was an excellent father, and those accusations his wife Samantha made against him last year were nonsense. After 3 blocks, she felt the sweat collect on the back of her neck. The lawns of all the expensive houses were turning brown at the edges from the long dry spell, and most of the driveways were empty. For the next 3 blocks, the street climbed at a steeper grade, but she refused to slacken her pace. Okaya had learned that in Toronto during the month of August, many people were on holiday, especially the wealthy ones. They called it going up north. When Mr. Wyler's son Simon was just a baby, and Mr. Wyler and Samantha were still married, the family went up north to a cottage, and Okaya went with them. Why they would leave their air-conditioned home to spend a week in a woodshed with an old refrigerator, a place with bugs and snakes outside, was a mystery to her. Strangest of all, one afternoon they caught 7 fish and insisted on throwing them all back in the lake. She arrived every day by 7:30. Mr. Wyler was always up, his stereo on loud, prancing around the kitchen, chopping up fresh fruit. Sometimes he played his piano. On the weeks he had Simon, he would make breakfast while listening to a man named Billy Joel. Apparently Mr. Joel played piano too. Her employer even named his dog Billy. Simon had just turned 4 years old and was already learning to read. Short words, but Mr. Wyler was so proud. A few weeks earlier, he bought some colorful magnetic letters and put them on the front of his refrigerator. Each night, he spelled a short word, and when Simon came down for breakfast, the boy would read it. First, D-O-G, then C-A-T, then H-O-U-S-E, then T-R-A-I-N. As she climbed the stone steps to the front door, Okaya was surprised to see that the newspaper was still there. Usually, Mr. Wyler had read it by the time she arrived, and he often showed her an article he thought would interest her. This morning, with so much on his mind, he probably didn't have time. She scooped the paper up and put her key in the door. It was unlocked. Mr. Wyler had probably been outside earlier before the paper came and forgotten. I'll bet the poor man couldn't sleep, she thought. His parents and two older brothers had been at the house last night for Sunday night dinner, and Okaya had been there to help out. The family had fought about their business. That, on top of the trial starting today, must have upset him. It was quiet inside the house. There was no music playing, no clatter of dishes in the kitchen, no patter of Simon's little feet. And where was Billy? Every morning when the dog heard Okaya come in, he would bark with happiness, stand up on his back legs to greet her. The house was hot. Mr. Wyler often forgot to put on the air conditioning before he went to sleep, especially lately when he was so upset. She took off her backpack and slid it under the front hall desk. At last she heard the click of dog tags on Billy's collar. He poked his head around the corner of the living room. "Billy, my favorite little doggie," she clapped her hands together. "Where's Simon?" Saying Simon always brought an instant response from the dog, but Billy seemed uninterested. He lowered his head. Must be the heat, Okaya thought. I better get you some water. She swung open the kitchen door, but the dog was reluctant to follow. The first thing that hit her was the smell. Something strong, horrible. She saw the blood, a dark red splotch on the clean white tile floor. She would use one of the rags under the sink to wipe it up, she thought. Then she saw Mr. Wyler. He was lying on the floor near the refrigerator. His eyes were open, vacant. She ran to him. "Did you fall, sir?" There were cuts across his white shirt, the one she'd ironed for him on Friday. So many cuts. On his neck, too. And the blood, all the blood. Her heart was pounding. She was having trouble breathing, thinking. "Wait," she thought, hearing the silence of the house. "Simon!" she shrieked, louder than she thought she knew how to yell, and raced to the stairs. Chapter 2. For some reason known only to him, every summer, homicide detective Ari Greene's father insisted on repainting the railing on the front steps of his house. "One of these years I'm going to scrape the damn things down," Greene thought as he grabbed two thin vertical bars and yanked them back and forth to make sure they were secure. The railing wobbled a bit. He'd need to fill in the cement, too. Even this early in the morning it was hot, and the heat accumulated on the concrete steps. His dad had made Greene a fresh pot of tea and was drinking his usual instant coffee from an old Toronto maple leaf's mug. Greene laid out the morning's newspaper under the railing and opened a can of black paint with a screwdriver. The can had lasted two summers already. "I think there's enough for one more year," he said. His father reached in with a long stir stick. "Let's hope." Greene had just picked up a brush when the emergency beeper on his hip went off. He hadn't expected a call today because he was number 4 on the handwritten list posted in the bureau of who was in line for the next murder. He picked up his cell phone and called in. "Toronto's turning into Murder City," the dispatcher said. Her name was Denise, a tough old battle axe Greene had known for years. "This is the 4th of the night." "Must be the heat," Greene said. "It's not the heat, it's the humidity." Denise couldn't wait to fill him in on the details of the three other homicides. In the Jane Finch corridor, shots were fired, and a 7-year-old girl at a backyard birthday party was hit by a stray bullet. Downtown in the entertainment district, a med student up from Buffalo got stabbed when he jumped in to break up a fight. And a home invader out in Etobicoke beat a babysitter to death when she wouldn't open the family safe.
"What have I got?" Green asked Denise.
His father took the paint can lid and tapped it back into place with the back of his brush. Green had been on the homicide squad for 5 years, and they both knew the drill. When a murder call came in, he dropped everything else in his life.
"You heard of Terence Wyler? From the Wyler Foods grocery store?" Denise asked. "The guy who's going out with April Goodling, the Hollywood star? She goes through men like water. Wyler's divorce trial was supposed to start today."
Green read the front page of the newspaper on the porch.
"Divorce from hell trial," he said.
His father picked up the paintbrushes and the stir stick.
"Lover boy's dead. This morning the Filipino nanny found him stabbed in his kitchen."
Denise sounded excited to deliver the bad news.
"His 4-year-old boy was asleep upstairs. Doesn't know what happened yet."
"On my way," Green said after she gave him the address.
"I'll clean up," his father said. "Call you tonight."
Green bent down and kissed his dad on his forehead, then jumped into his car and slapped the emergency light on the roof. 10 minutes later, he pulled his 88 Oldsmobile behind a police cruiser in front of 221 Hillside Drive and stepped out into the morning sunlight. Taking his time, he looked up at the house, which was elevated well above the street.
"Hello, detective,"
a young policewoman at the front door said when he got to the top of the stairs. She was a thin East Indian woman with a slender nose.
"P.C. Mudar. I'm the first officer on the scene."
"Detective Green."
He shook her hand. It was sweaty.
"Your first homicide call?"
"Yes, sir."
"Where's the little boy?"
"Upstairs, with the nanny."
Her voice was thin.
"I told her to keep him in the room."
"You see him?"
"For a second. He was waking up. The nanny says she found Mr. Wyler in the kitchen when she came to work this morning."
Mudar had a palm-sized police notebook, and she flipped it open.
"She said that was about 7:30. I checked the body. There are no vital signs."
"You called for a backup to cordon off the street?" Mudar shook her head.
"Not yet, sir."
"Don't worry," Green said. "I called it when I was driving over. Cars will be here any minute. Send someone to Tim Hortons to get a chocolate milk and a donut. With sprinkles."
"Yes, sir."
"I told dispatch to hold off the ambulance until we get the boy out of here. Anyone else in the house?"
"No, sir. I checked. It's clear."
"Good work."
Mundar smiled and closed her notebook.
"What's the nanny's name?" he asked.
She opened her notebook again.
"Arceli Okaya. Says the boy's mother has been acting strange the last few weeks."
As he driven to the house, Denise, the dispatcher, had briefed Green on the recent police occurrences involving the wife. Samantha Wyler had been harassing her soon-to-be ex-husband with nasty voice messages and angry emails that were close to the line but not actual threats. A pair of rookie police constables had warned her to stop. The usual stuff. With 4 murders on the go, there'd be a scramble among the homicide detectives to grab good officers to work their cases. Green called Daniel Kennicott, a smart young cop who'd worked with him on his last murder. Kennicott had his cell phone set, so if Green called, it had a special ringtone.
"Detective Green?" Kennicott said.
"Where are you?" Green asked.
"On patrol. Started my shift about 30 minutes ago."
Kennicott sounded sleepy.
"First day back. What's up?"
The two men had a complicated relationship. Kennicott's older brother, Michael, was murdered 5 years earlier. At the time, Kennicott was a lawyer at one of the top downtown firms. 12 months later, when the investigation stalled, Kennicott quit his law job and joined the force, determined to make the homicide squad in record time. It was Green's only unsolved case.
A new murder. Green gave him the address. He was going to start Kennicott off with the toughest assignment of the day, informing the family of the murder.
Be there in 10 minutes, Kennicott said.
Green turned to Mudar. What's the name of the boy upstairs?
Beads of perspiration pooled on the side of the young policewoman's face. The reality of homicide work was that usually it was the greenest of the green cops who were the first to arrive. This time, Mudar didn't need her notebook.
Simon.
Her bottom lip began to quiver.
It's gruesome.
Green put his hand on her shoulder.
Stay here and cover the door.
He looked at the cloudless sky. There was a smell of mint in the air. He must have crushed some coming up the steps.
Yes, sir.
The wash of relief across Mudar's face was palpable. Green walked through the front hall and opened the kitchen door with his elbow. Already knowing what he'd see inside didn't make it any less disturbing. Weiler's fit, trim body was splayed out on the tile floor, arms flung to the sides, apparently helpless in the face of a knife attack that had lacerated his chest, the top of his shoulders, and his neck. Green bent close to the body without touching it. There were no obvious cuts to Weiler's fingers or forearms. Forensics would look for skin or DNA under his fingernails, but at first blush there were no defensive wounds. The smell in the hot room was overpowering. Scanning the kitchen, Green saw a half-cantaloupe on the counter, fruit flies swarming all around it. The rest of the room was as spotless as the hallway had been. All the cupboard doors were closed. Green put his hand inches from the dishwasher. It was cool. Same with the stove, where he noticed 3 dish towels draped over the handle. The first was red and white, and the second was green and white. There was a gap the width of a towel and then another green one. A wooden block near the sink held a number of black-handled knives. The widest groove was empty. No sign of a knife on the floor or the counter. There was nothing else Green could do here until the forensic officer arrived. He had a sudden urge to be out of this room of death. He had to go upstairs to talk to a boy who no longer had a father. Chapter 3. Ted DiPaolo opened the door to his law office and stared at his desk. What a fucking mess.
Damn.
He hated paperwork. Even more, he hated a boring week like the one coming up. Today, nothing was doing, and he'd be stuck pushing that pile of paper around. Tomorrow, he had a guilty plea for a drunk driver. Wednesday, a sentencing on a fraud case. Thursday, a meeting with a new client charged with stealing from his employer. Friday? Zip. He could do all this in his sleep. If there was one thing DiPaolo couldn't stand even more than dishonest prosecutors or incompetent judges, it was not having enough to do. Not having a big case on the go, not getting into court to cross-examine a witness, not having the press lapping up his every word. Bloody summer. His law practice was too damn slow, as if everyone were on holiday, even his best criminals. DiPaolo needed to be in court the way an actor needed to be on stage. That's why he'd started his career as a crown attorney, where prosecutors were on their feet all day long. With his love of doing trials and his great capacity for work, he had risen through the ranks fast, became the youngest ever head crown of the Toronto office at the age of 41. He thrived in the job, couldn't get enough of the pressure, the profile. Then, 5 years ago, his wife, Olive, was diagnosed with liver cancer. She died in 3 months, and in the blink of an eye, he had to take care of his 2 teenage kids. All those years before that, he'd been a part-time parent, practically living at the office. That was no longer an option. He quit and went into private practice so he'd have more time. At first, Kyle, then 14, and Lauren, 12, clung to him, wanted him home every night for dinner. Funny thing. Just as he got used to it and started to crave their company, they turned into full-fledged teenagers, on the go all the time. And perhaps they knew their dad was much easier to live with when he got his daily dose of the courtroom. Soon he was back to doing big cases, sleepless nights and crazy hours, with the added bonus of a new closeness to his children. But that was time-dated, like a container of yogurt in the fridge. Kyle was away on a 6-week canoe trip and would be off to university in September. Lauren was home, taking a summer school course. Another year and she'd be gone, too. He stopped for a moment at the credenza near his office door and picked up a framed photo. Olive died 4 months after their 20th anniversary. On the first Mother's Day after her death, the kids gave him this picture of the two of them on top of Ayers Rock. They had taken the hiking trip to Australia to celebrate their 45th birthdays, which were 1 week apart. Ted was very tall, over 6'6", and big. Olive was quite short, fine, and delicate. It was his private ritual to look at the photo every time he entered and exited the office. In a job where the demands on his time and emotions were so extreme, he was determined to keep this piece of his own life intact. Half a decade. He'd never forgotten. He settled behind his desk, and the phone rang. DiPaolo smiled. On Saturday night, he'd been invited over to some friend's house for dinner, and they'd introduced him to a woman named Chiara. She was an orthopedic surgeon a few years older, smart and independent, Italian even, though a dark beauty from Sicily, in contrast with his blonde, northern Italian blood. They joked about who started work earlier on Monday mornings, and as he was leaving, he gave her his card and said, "Call if you want. Earlier the better." After Olive died, DiPaolo had waited a few years before he started dating. At first, he made the predictable mistakes, talked incessantly about his late wife, his children, or his career as a criminal lawyer. Lessons learned. He wasn't going to blow this one. He leaned far back in his chair. "Hi there." His voice was warm, even sexy.
"Ted, so glad you're in early," a male voice said.
He recognized it immediately. It was Winston Findell, a family lawyer who sent DiPaolo a lot of work.
"Winston, oh, hi."
He snapped straight up in his seat. "You must be on your way to court." Findell was an elderly British barrister who'd moved to Canada 10 years earlier. Trading on his English accent, his well-tailored suits, and his courtly manner, he had quickly established himself as a leading light in the local family law bar. His specialty was representing women splitting up from rich husbands. When a client had to testify in a divorce trial, he sent them to DiPaolo to prepare them for court. DiPaolo had been working with Samantha Wyler, a particularly difficult woman, since the beginning of July, and her divorce trial was starting this morning.
"Unfortunately," Findell said, "the trial has been cancelled."
This was Findell's style, very British, understated.
"Cancelled?" DiPaolo asked.
"Why?"
"My part in this matter has ended. Ms. Wyler will now be your full-time client."
"My client? Divorce isn't a crime."
"Ah, but murder is," Findell said.
"What?" DiPaolo said. "Who?" DiPaolo had watched as Samantha, or Sam as she insisted on being called, had become increasingly unglued in recent weeks. What had she done?
"Ms. Wyler's now late husband was found at his home this morning. Victim, it seems, of a great many stab wounds. Puts a crimp in the divorce action."
"Oh, no.
I just received a phone call from a homicide detective, Ari Greene. You know the gentleman?
Good cop, DePaolo said.
The detective was inquiring as to the whereabouts of our formerly mutual client.
After all his years in the court, DePaolo prided himself in his ability to take startling news in stride, but he needed a minute to absorb this. The air-conditioned office felt hot.
Where's Sam?
The tumblers in his mind were locking into gear.
She was sitting on the steps of my office a few minutes ago when I arrived, Findell said as calmly as he'd tell a colleague where he'd gone for lunch. She's in my office now and most upset.
And a dangerous client for you, DePaolo thought. Findell wanted to pass her off fast like a real-life hot potato. His law chambers, as he insisted on calling his luxurious office, were in a brownstone in Yorkville, a trendy midtown location, near all the best restaurants for his ladies-who-lunch clientele. It would be a short drive.
I'll get right over there.
DePaolo reached for his old leather briefcase, grabbed a few pens and a clean pad of paper, and rushed out. Samantha Wyler could be questioned by the police or even arrested at any moment. His office was on the 11th floor. At the elevator, the numbers above the door were at 6, then 5, then 4. To hell with it. He headed to the stairwell, keeping one hand on the steel railing. He skipped down the concrete steps. It wasn't until he got to the 3rd floor that DePaolo realized he hadn't paused at the anniversary photo on his way out. He gripped the railing, then kept going down. Chapter 4. It was a perfect room for a boy to grow up in, Harry Green thought, closing the door behind him and grinning at the dark-eyed child nestled in the bed on the far wall. Tucked in next to him, a short woman was reading him a book called Really Big Trains. A large poster of Thomas the Tank Engine smiled down on them from above. On the wood floor, a throw rug featured a print of Curious George, forever being chased by the man with the yellow hat. In a bay window that overlooked the street, the built-in sitting area was covered with a half-finished Lego construction of a tall building.
Hello.
The boy smiled at Green, remarkably at ease with a total stranger coming into his room. He patted a small black dog at his side.
I bet you're Simon, Green said.
Yup, he said. Arcelli told me someone would be coming to see me. She said my daddy had to leave early. This is my dog, Billy.
Green kept a smile on his face. Arcelli's a special friend.
When she reads about the train named Victor, she says Victor.
Simon laughed. The nanny nodded at Green and forced herself to laugh along. The boy had deep, dark eyes.
Have you ever been in a fire truck? Green asked.
At daycare, they taught us stop, drop, and roll.
Simon popped out of bed, stood erect on the carpet, dropped to the ground, and rolled over at Green's feet.
Green got down on one knee. Ever been in a police car?
I've got one.
Simon jumped up and pulled a basket out from under his bed. It was packed with cars and trucks and trains. He expertly extracted a black and white car.
This one's my bestest.
He made driving noises, vroom, 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 as he rolled it along the edge of the bed.
Police emergency! Police emergency!
He called out in as deep a voice as he could.
Guess what? Green said. A police car's going to take you to Arcelli's place.
Simon turned back to Green, a confused look on his face.
This is zoo day at daycare camp.
It's so hot, the animals need to stay inside, Green said.
Simon thought about this for a moment.
Arcelli's apartment is hot, too. She told me.
What do you want to take with you?
Simon dove under his bed again and brought out a plastic bucket. A moment of rummaging, and he found a police badge. "This," he said, showing it to Green. He grabbed a well-worn Sesame Street doll. "And Bert." He looked at the dog, who was still on the bed. "And Billy. Are dogs allowed in police cars?"
"Sure."
"A policewoman bought you chocolate milk and donuts for breakfast. Arcelli's going to go get them, and you can eat here in your room." Simon furrowed his brow. "My mom lets me eat in front of the TV, but Daddy says I have to eat in the kitchen or the dining room."
"That's a good rule. But today, we can do something special."
The nanny left, and Green glanced out the bay window. The squad cars he'd ordered had cut off the street on both sides of the house. Green pulled out a basket of Brio trains and wooden track.
"Do you want to work on this with me?"
"Sure,"
Simon stretched out on the floor. Within a few minutes, they'd built a figure eight with an extension looping off to an outer ring. A second spur line circled under a bridge and curled back to a painted wood station.
"You're fun to play with," Simon said.
Green reached back for more rails and felt something soft touch his arm. It was the boy's hand. One Saturday afternoon, when he was 6 years old, Green's father came home early from work, and they took two buses to get to a store called George's Trains on Mount Pleasant Avenue. When Green walked in, he could hardly breathe, so overwhelming was the place. The walls were lined with hand-painted locomotives, and the salesmen, none of them young, wore gray and white striped conductor's hats. Best of all, a large train ran all the way around the store, high up on the walls, toot-tooting every minute or so. Green's father could afford only one circular track, with a locomotive and a coal car. Green spent countless hours in the basement running the train around and around. There was a special liquid that came in a glass bottle, and three drops of it would produce steam once the engine warmed up. The nanny opened Simon's bedroom door, quickly shutting it behind her.
"Here's your donut," she said, "and chocolate milk."
Simon reached for the donut.
"Sprinkles?" he smiled. "Drink your milk first."
She put a straw in the milk carton and held it out to him.
"Careful, no spilling."
"This man likes trains, like my mom," Simon said after he took a sip.
"Most people like trains," Okaya said.
"Arcelli had to take a long airplane ride to get to Canada," Simon explained. "Her family is far away, but she doesn't cry. My dad doesn't cry, but my mom always cries when I have to say goodbye."
Green got up from the floor.
"That's because she loves you," he said.
"She kisses me at night when she thinks I'm asleep, and I know she's crying, like she did..."
"Simon, take another sip," Okaya said. "Enough talking.
I'm saying that Mommy cries."
Simon put the straw back into his mouth.
"Yes."
"Here's the donut."
She had wrapped it in a white napkin. "Be careful, no crumbs on the floor."
"She cried last night," Simon said.
Green and Okaya exchanged glances.
"Silly Simon," Okaya said. "Last night you were not at your mother's house. You slept here."
"My mom came into my room here at my dad's house. She kissed me, and she was crying."
Simon took a bite out of the donut and swallowed it.
"She said she wouldn't see me for a long time. How come?"
Instead of looking at his nanny, Simon looked squarely at Green, the man who'd appeared in his life, built trains with him on the floor, and told him he wasn't going to daycare camp today. He picked a red sprinkle off the donut.
"How come?"
Simon asked again. Chapter 5.
"I'm looking for Weiler Foods.
Officer Daniel Kennicott jumped out of his patrol car and grabbed the arm of a muscle-bound man carrying a basket of fresh corn with both hands. Kennicott had just parked at the Ontario Food Terminal, a gigantic tract of land in the southwest part of the city.
Main building.
The man indicated the direction with his chin.
Turn right, and right again. Can't miss it.
Thanks. Kennicott took off at a run. The food terminal was one of the biggest fresh food depots in North America, and the lot was filled to capacity with farmers' pickup trucks and vehicles belonging to buyers from every corner of the province. One caught his eye, a paneled van painted in gaudy orange and green colors, the words, "It's Weiler Fresh," standing out in old-fashioned block letters. He was fighting the clock. "You're going to notify the oldest brother, Nathan Weiler, the one you see on all those billboard ads," Detective Greene had told Kennicott half an hour before when he'd gotten to Terence Weiler's house. "The parents and the middle brother, Jason, who's disabled by some rare disease, live northwest of the city, too far a drive. Better to let Nathan tell the family. Throw on your siren and get there fast. I don't want him to hear about this from the press." Kennicott had looked at the other patrol cars that cut off the street. Greene could have grabbed any of those cops and given them this assignment. "No problem," he'd said. The food terminal was a large warehouse with a huge open courtyard in the middle. Storefronts rimmed the perimeter on all four sides with colorful names like Rosie's Bananas, So Green Organics, Romano Pasta Company, Upper Canadian Cheese. A network of concrete paths ran around the complex, and a constant stream of electric trolleys laden with all manner of produce zipped in and out of stores. Their drivers beeped their high-pitched horns as they whirled around like hepped-up go-kart drivers on a familiar track. It was easy to find Weiler Foods. The garish facade featured the store's orange and green colors with the words, "It's Weiler Fresh," on a banner high across the entrance. Inside was a beehive of activity. A lineup of farmers brought in cartons of food to show Weiler employees, all dressed in orange and green aprons. Nathan Weiler was right in the middle of it all, pacing back and forth behind a long rectangular table, his striped bow tie slightly askew. He barked out orders as he pawed through the trays of fresh food his minions brought up for inspection. Kennicott recognized the man immediately. Weiler Foods was a well-known high-end food store in Midtown Toronto. It had recently launched a billboard ad campaign across the city that featured a photo of Nathan with his sleeves rolled up, arms filled with fresh produce, wearing the distinctive bow tie. Behind him were old photos of two other men wearing the same tie and handling produce. Obviously, these were his father and grandfather. The tagline read, "I'm Nathan Weiler. For three generations, it's always been Weiler Fresh."
"Fucking heat wave," Weiler said.
He was a big man with broad, hunched-over shoulders. He grabbed a tray of blueberries from one of his employees.
"This stuff's all shriveled to shit."
Kennicott strode up to the table. Despite the fact that he was in full uniform, no one seemed to notice him.
"Look at this scrawny stuff they're trained to hide."
Weiler dug through a carton of romaine and yanked a thin head of lettuce from the bottom row. It was brown around the edges.
"Excuse me, Mr. Weiler," Kennicott said.
Weiler fixed him with a pair of eyes that were a remarkable translucent green. He wasn't an attractive man. Up close, his brownish hair had the plastic look of cheap color. He had a deep, doubled chin, but the eyes made the rest of his face irrelevant.
"Yeah?"
Weiler didn't seem at all surprised to see a police officer in his store. Squeezing the ends of a cantaloupe, he heaved it back into its box and turned to another employee.
"These are good. Ask if he's got any honeydew."
"Could I speak to you for a moment, sir?" Kennicott asked.
Weiler held an oversized avocado out to him. "Organic, from Florida. Amazing stuff. What is it, officer?"
"I'd rather speak to you in private." Kennicott took the avocado. It had a thick, scaly skin. Someone shoved a cluster of fresh basil at Weiler. He tore off a bottom leaf and popped it into his mouth.
"This is the best. Americans have this quick cooling method. Stuff stays fresh for 10 days.
He took back the avocado from Kennicott and offered him a leaf.
"Try it."
"No, thanks. I really must..."
"Look."
Weiler spread his arms out at the train of food being brought up to him.
"Monday morning, peak buying hour. With this heat, no one has enough supply."
"Sir, this is urgent." Weiler's fingers danced over a basket of green zucchini.
"They're not great, but we better grab 'em. See if they have any yellows,"
he said to yet another employee before he turned back to Kennicott.
"Officer, you must be new at the division. Go help yourself to whatever you want. Not a problem."
"It's about your brother," Kennicott said. Weiler's eyes widened and his shoulders slumped. His hands tightened around a celery stalk.
"Jason, he in the hospital again?"
"Please, sir," Kennicott said. "Where can we talk alone?"
"Back in my office."
Weiler tossed the celery at another employee.
"They're fine," he said. "Try to get some carrots."
He turned to the front of the store.
"Paulette, I'll be in back for 5, he yelled.
A young redhead who was working the cash register looked up. She had a beautiful smile. The office was a small cubbyhole tucked away in the corner. An old steel desk, stacked high with order books, sat against the back wall. A pinboard behind it had heaps of paper stuck on every inch. 2 round black ashtrays were filled with butts, many of them half-smoked.
"We're not fancy."
Weiler closed the door behind them. The room had a rancid smell of moldy fruit.
"My father and my grandfather worked out of here, too. Where's Jason?"
Kennicott realized that Weiler had naturally assumed this was about his disabled brother.
"It's not Jason. I'm afraid it's Terence."
Relief washed over Weiler's face, his concern immediately replaced by frustration and anger.
"What bullshit charge did Samantha cook up this time?"
"She didn't charge him with anything."
"What did she do?"
He looked genuinely confused.
"I have terrible news."
Kennicott spoke quickly. He'd done this once before, informed a family about a murder. It was best to be direct. "Your brother Terence was found dead in his house this morning."
"Dead?"
Weiler's jaw gaped open. "He was killed." Weiler flinched. His green eyes bulged, then receded. The first shockwave of understanding hit, and he stumbled back as if he'd been smacked in the solar plexus with a 2x4.
"Killed?"
He struggled to get the word out.
"I can't tell you much more right now, but clearly it was murder." "Murdered?"
Weiler's breathing was forced.
"Terry?"
"The nanny found him."
"Arcelli?"
His hands went to his face.
"She was at Terry's house last night. We were all there for dinner. Jason drove her home."
"This morning, when she came to work."
"Where's Simon? It's Terry's week with the boy."
"He's okay. We've taken him to the nanny's apartment."
"Who did this?"
"We don't know yet." Weiler was nodding, dazed.
"That explains it,"
he said, almost a whisper.
"Explains what, sir?"
Weiler reached down to his belt. Kennicott heard a hard plastic click sound, and a second later, Weiler tossed a battered BlackBerry at him. "Terry and I talk in email about 20 times a day, and I haven't been able to get him all morning. I figured he was distracted because of the trial starting today." Weiler's eyes were right on Kennicott, piercing, looking for answers.
"What about Samantha?" he said, anger shoving the shock aside. "Where the hell is the bitch?"
Chapter 6 Ted DiPaolo swung his Lexus sedan into the gravel driveway behind Winston Findel's Mercedes. The family lawyer's license plate read, "Alimony." The front door was open, and Findel's ground-floor office was at the front of the house. Samantha Weiler sat on a quilted couch. She wore a short black skirt, a loose-fitting cotton blouse, and a pair of sporty-looking sandals. Her arms were crossed, and she was rocking back and forth. Findel was at his desk, the sunlight streaming in through the windows behind him. Weiler gazed up at DiPaolo. Her dark hair hung down limp and dirty. She flicked her head to get it out of her face, a nervous tic that he'd noticed the first time they'd met. Her eyes looked tired, her face haggard and exhausted. Even in her bedraggled state, Samantha was attractive. She had a long neck, broad shoulders, and a full face, centered by warm brown eyes. He had learned over the last few weeks that for her, her natural good looks were more of a burden than a blessing.
"Miss Weiler hasn't said a word since she came in."
Findel's voice was unusually restrained. "We need to speak alone," DiPaolo said.
"I anticipated that."
Findel vaulted from behind his desk. He was a gawky man, all arms and legs.
"I'm off to the local Starbucks."
He made the A in the coffee shop's name almost sound like an O. DiPaolo listened to Findel's footsteps recede down the hall. When he heard the front door close, he pulled the nearest chair closer to the sofa. Weiler was looking at the floor, rocking harder now. There was a teapot on a side table, and the room had a gentle smell of some exotic tea. "Sam," DiPaolo whispered, "we need to talk right away. The police are going to find you in a few minutes." She seemed to roll into a tight ball, her head above her knees. There was something in her hands that she was protecting, like a child cradling her special blanket. "They're going to have a lot of questions." She looked at him, a thin line of mascara streaking down her cheeks. "You have the right to remain silent," he said. "You don't have to answer any questions." She nodded. "But that won't stop them from questioning you. They're going to want to know where you were last night. This is no time to be ashamed if you did something foolish. If you have an alibi, I need to know it now." She froze. "I don't care where you were, and the police won't..." Her body lurched. For a moment, DiPaolo thought she was going to vomit. She opened her arms and held out a red and white dish towel. He was about to take it, then his lawyer's instincts kicked in and he pulled back. "Sam, listen to me. Put that on the carpet and open it. Slowly." Fixing him with her eyes, she placed the towel down and unfolded the corners one at a time, like a jeweler unwrapping a precious stone. DiPaolo felt a tingle at the edge of his fingers. Before she lifted the last layer, he could already see the outline of the object inside.
"It's from our kitchen,"
Weiler said, speaking at last. She exposed a black-handled knife, stained from top to bottom with blood.
"Our kitchen," DiPaolo thought. "Interesting choice of words."
She looked at him, those dark eyes now swimming in confusion.
"I took it," she said.
"Well,
DiPaolo said, fighting to keep his voice steady. We're going to have to find a way to give it back. Chapter 7 Right now, Margaret Kwan had to be statue still. The door of her hotel room, number 403, was open a crack, and she stood at the threshold, her camera tucked into her palm. Even after 20 years as a celebrity journalist for Faces magazine, chasing Hollywood stars all across the continent, she lived for moments like this. She'd gotten this prime location the night before when, for $50, a Somali limo driver tipped her off that April Goodling wasn't holed up at the Four Seasons, the hotel usually frequented by stars who came to Toronto, but was here at the Gladstone, a boutique hotel in the West End. This was typical of Goodling. A control freak, in Kwan's opinion, she complained bitterly about being hounded by the celebrity press, at the same time courting their attention at every turn. This was especially true when one of her new films was about to be released, or when she was showing off her newest boyfriend. Last September, when she'd been here at the Toronto International Film Festival to promote her latest film, Goodling had met Terence Wyler at the Wyler Foods Festival picnic. Remit, to be exact. The pair had dated 20 years before when they were students at a small college in Vermont and hadn't seen each other since. For once, the attraction on Goodling's part appeared to be genuine. Kwan, who came to Toronto every year to cover the festival, received a tip from an actor who'd been a part-time waiter at the picnic and had snagged a picture of Goodling and Wyler kissing behind the tent. The story went international. Everyone loved the old flames rekindled angle. Wyler and his wife had broken up the next week. This morning, Kwan knew that Goodling had an 8:15 pickup. The actress planned to slip out the side door to her limo. Kwan had positioned one photographer dressed like a street person in the bus shelter across the road. A second, wearing a tracksuit, was in the lobby. With her door open a crack, Kwan had a clear sightline of Goodling's door, room 408, diagonally across the hall. It was the part of the job Kwan adored, catching the moment. No matter how rich and famous they were, there was no magical way for celebrities to get out of a hotel, no Scotty to beam them up. Sooner or later, they had to walk the walk, and Kwan was going to be there. Hard work. That's how she'd broken the Brad torn condom story, the Britney implant piece, and the Jessica sixth toe blockbuster. In her pursuit of celebrity trash, Kwan bought off hotel workers, charmed flight attendants, and cajoled hospital workers. She would wait endlessly in nightclub parking lots, hotel lobbies, and illegally parked cars. Most of all, she outthought the dumbass actors and their entourages of arrogant handlers. Of course, at her age, Kwan really shouldn't have been doing this anymore. By the time they were 45, most reporters had graduated to being editors, content to lounge behind a desk and let the young guns stay up on all-night stakeouts or go through a celebrity's garbage before the truck arrived. Her parents thought she was flushing her brains down the toilet. Last weekend, she trekked out to Long Island for dinner. There were her two younger sisters parked in the living room with their lily-white husbands and their kids in Oshkosh and Ralph Lauren. All of them had been right on time, of course. Kwan was an hour late. What did they expect? She just landed the Mark and Jennifer satanic fertility story, for God's sake. But all her family saw was Margaret, still single, with no professional degree behind her name. The night ended, as they always did, with Kwan and her parents screaming at each other in full Korean rage. Goodling's door opened a crack. Gotcha, Kwan thought. She tensed. A stocky guy in a baseball jacket came out and looked down the hall in the other direction, toward the elevator. Kwan shut her door before he turned back her way. She counted on her fingers.
She estimated that 10 seconds was enough time for the bodyguard to check that the coast was clear and get Goodling into the hallway. She'd paced it out late last night. It was 10 steps from her room to 408, then 15 steps to the elevator. 8, 9, 10. Kwan stepped into the hall. Right away, she knew something was wrong. The bodyguard was staring back toward room 408, looking concerned. Goodling was still inside. Kwan had no choice. If she turned back, it would alert the guard. She'd planned to film a secret video with a handheld camera while they were in the elevator together. She started down the hall. A few steps in, she heard a voice coming from the room. "No! No!" It was Goodling. She was screaming. Kwan's heart beat fast. She kept going. 5 more steps, and she'd be at the door. Then she made a rookie mistake. She sped up. Her quickened pace caught the corner of the bodyguard's eye. His head jerked around. Moving with surprising dexterity for such a big man, he lunged inside the hotel room. He was slamming the door shut. There was only one thing to do. Kwan pressed the video shoot button and dove straight ahead, like a goalie in a soccer match reaching for a top corner shot. She heard Goodling scream out something and felt a whoosh of air as the door banged shut. Kwan's chin hit the wood floor and her teeth rattled at the back of her jaw. Then her whole body crashed. "I really am getting too old for this," she thought, lying spread out in the middle of the empty hallway. She turned the camera toward her and switched it to display mode. A short video of Goodling played on the screen. Kwan played it again, this time frame by frame, like the Zapruder film of President Kennedy getting shot in Dallas. Kwan could feel the adrenaline still in her body. Her chest and ribcage were sore, her chin was ripped open, and her back teeth felt tight. But it didn't matter. She'd hit pay dirt. Without a doubt, right there at frame 34 was the next cover of Faces magazine. Chapter 8. Ari Greene stepped out of the elevator on the 11th floor of the office building at 350 Bay Street, right across from the old City Hall courthouse, and checked his watch. It was 9:50. As usual, he was early. A narrow metal sign that read DePaolo and Parrish, Specialists in Criminal Law, 1105, pointed to his right down a poorly lit hallway. The door to suite 1105 was a dull gray, and his opening it triggered an unseen bell that chimed out a high-pitched ding-dong. The law firm's lobby was a mishmash of old sofas and a smattering of dated magazines. On top of the pile, an issue of the Hockey News from last spring celebrated the Toronto Maple Leafs' unlikely Stanley Cup win. This summer, the team released the veteran goaltender who'd been the surprise hero of the series. Instead, they signed a young Swedish goalie. Green's father had been apoplectic. The reception desk was empty. The window behind it was covered by a dusty-looking blind clamped shut. Green peeked over the edge and saw stacks of cardboard evidence boxes. An old-fashioned grandfather clock stood on the far wall, ticking as its pendulum swung back and forth. "Ari!" Green turned to see Ted DePaolo striding down the narrow corridor, the top button of his shirt open, his tie askew. The lawyer's whole face broke into a grin as the two men shook hands. He had one of those winning smiles that lit up every room he was in, which he used like a weapon when he was in court to cajole witnesses, ingratiate himself to judges, and charm juries. DePaolo held out his hand. "Thanks for coming down. You're here early."
"Bad habit," Green said.
He followed the lawyer down the hallway, thinking, as he always did when confronted with DePaolo, how well the man's stature matched his big voice and big ego. They passed the office of DePaolo's partner, Nancy Parrish, who Green knew from a previous murder trial. Her door was closed. Green well remembered when DiPaolo had been the head of the downtown Toronto Crown Attorney's office. He'd been tough even on the up-and-coming lawyers who tended to idolize him. And he had loved big trials. The higher the profile, the better. "How are the kids?" Green asked when DiPaolo had ushered him into his office. Unlike the barely furnished dinginess of the rest of the office, DiPaolo's space was beautifully laid out.
"Growing up too fast."
DiPaolo motioned Green to the far chair near the window and settled himself into the other one. He left the door open behind him.
"Your oldest must be in university," Green said. "Good memory, detective," DiPaolo said. "Only my daughter's left at home, and just for one more year."
Green scanned the room. On the credenza near the entrance was a picture of DiPaolo hiking with his late wife, Olive, a lovely-looking Chinese woman. There were photos of their kids at various ages, beautiful children. He returned his gaze to DiPaolo. Both men knew the time for their cordial chit-chat was over. The defense lawyer had called him an hour earlier and asked if he could come over right away. Something urgent was all he would say.
"Samantha Wyler," DiPaolo checked his watch. "She's my client. I assume you want to talk to her in relation to the death of her husband."
"Seven stab wounds," Green said. "I think murder's the appropriate word." DiPaolo nodded, keeping his face neutral, careful not to give away whether this was news to him or not.
"Know where I can find her?" Green asked.
"I do. I need time to talk to her." DiPaolo fiddled with his gold wedding band.
"If she has an alibi for last night, I'd like to hear it. The sooner the better."
The lawyer sneaked another look at his watch. He's stalling, Green thought, waiting for someone. The outer door opened, and Green heard the ding-dong of the bell. DiPaolo's whole face broke into a grin. Sharp footsteps pounded down the hall, and a moment later a pencil-thin black woman in a long dress and high heels stood in the doorway. She was young. In her hand was a plastic shopping bag with a Longo's Fine Foods logo on it.
"Excuse me," the woman said out of breath. "I'm looking for Detective Ari Green."
Green stood and extended his hand.
"You found him?"
"Barbara Delacroix."
She gave him a surprisingly firm handshake for someone with such a slender arm.
"I'm a lawyer at Levine and Sunderlingham."
Green looked at the bag.
"What can I do for you?"
Can I talk to you alone, please, sir, if you don't mind?"
DiPaolo popped out of his seat, his smile broader than ever.
"Let me show you to the boardroom."
Seconds later, Green was in a small windowless room, sitting across from Delacroix at an oval-shaped table.
"Detective Green,"
she put the bag on the table and spoke in an over-rehearsed monotone,
"the firm of Levine and Sunderlingham has been retained by a client who wishes to keep his or her identity anonymous. That client has instructed our firm to deliver to you the contents of this package."
Delacroix passed the bag across to him. She looked as if she'd just gotten rid of something highly infectious. Green pulled the top back. There was a clear plastic bag sealed inside. It contained a red and white dish towel.
"I don't imagine you know what's in here," Green said.
I'm instructed to tell you only what I've just said."
"Is it heavy?"
"Not too. I'm not supposed to say anything else."
"Sharp?"
"Yes."
She stopped. Her breath became forced.
"I'm sorry, officer. I mean, detective. I was only called to the bar 10 months ago."
"You did fine."
Green closed the outer bag.
"Tell the lawyers at your firm, mission accomplished. You delivered the bloody knife."
Delacroix scurried out and the door ding-donged again. Green strolled across the hall and found DiPaolo behind his desk, hanging up the phone. They both knew what had just happened. Samantha Wyler must have given DiPaolo the bloody knife, and he'd set up a double-blind, lawyer's style. Step one, he hired Levine and Sunderlingham. That way, he was their client, and his identity was protected. Step two, he instructed his new lawyers to pick up the knife. Step three, he got Green down to his office to facilitate the handover. This way, no trail led back to his client, Samantha Wyler.
Interesting meeting.
Green lifted the bag. Really? DiPaolo flashed his golden smile and pointed to the phone. That was Ms. Wyler. Where is she? DiPaolo shrugged. I'd rather not tell you right now. Trust me, she's not going anywhere. As I said, I need to talk to her first. Green thought of Parrish's closed office door. He was pretty sure Wyler was in there. We both know she has no legal obligation to speak to you, DiPaolo said. The smile was gone. DiPaolo always played hardball. The guy loved to win, but to his credit he played by the rules, and what he'd said was true. Green had no power to force Samantha Wyler to talk to the police. If she didn't, his only option would be to arrest her, and then she'd probably shut up entirely. There's a knife and a red and white towel missing from the murder scene. Green lifted up the bag. I want to know where she was last night. A fragile trust develops between a good lawyer and a detective on a tough case like this. DiPaolo had moved quickly to get the bloody knife returned. It showed good faith. Sometimes it was better to leave a suspect's lawyer alone with his client. He might talk the client into being realistic, entering a quick guilty plea for the best possible deal.
How much time do you need? Green asked. We have quite a bit of ground to cover.
This was defense lawyer code for let me work on her. She's still in denial.
If I'm going to arrest her, I'll call you first, Green said.
That's fair.
The longer it takes, the weaker her alibi becomes. Like fish, it starts to stink in a few days.
Don't I know it? DiPaolo said.
He looked at the plastic bag in Green's hand. He fidgeted again with his wedding ring. DiPaolo looked like a gambler who'd drawn a bad hand but was in too deep to pull out of the game, with nothing left to smile about.
Chapter 9. 49, please, Daniel Kennicott said to the woman standing next to the number display in the crowded elevator. He'd squeezed into the last available space among all.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.